Well, there are many parents right now who are in their 30s and 40s and maybe even the 50s that are not very well versed in the doctrinal teaching of the church simply because they didn't get it when they were young, or they have not been exposed to it as they grow older. What is your organization doing for those kind of people?
We're promoting the Baltimore Catechism. It's simple and it's short. It's easy to read and it has the fundamentals.
Mm-hmm. And also, we're one of the reasons that we decided to send our newsletter to all the priests in the diocese is to make sure that they're hearing some of what we're hearing. And to hopefully encourage them to begin to teach from the pulpit. I mean, that's the function of that homily at the Sunday Mass. And there are many priests who for years have skirted or avoided altogether the most difficult issues. So you see RCIA programs, the programs to bring converts into the church, ignoring the issues of contraception and divorce and remarriage. Because they're the hardest ones for Protestants to accept. And so rather than deal with those hard situations, they just pretend that those issues don't exist. I saw that for a number of years in my own parish, and I'm delighted to say that the pastor who's presently there teaches the RCIA program himself, and he uses the new catechism of the Catholic Church, and it's a program that's wonderful and as solid as a rock. He's an excellent teacher. But for too long, pastors have avoided those issues that might bring them criticism outside the church. They don't want to deal with that.
Do you think that was due to a fundamental deficiency in their personal knowledge of the faith, or was it an act of omission?
Well, I can't begin to guess at what motivates anyone. So individual priests, I have no idea why they avoid it. I have to guess that there's that human thing in all of us that wants people to like us and wants people to say nice things to us, mm-hmm. and doesn't want people to criticize us and yell at us.
Yes.
And maybe part of that is our omission in affirming our priests when they do the difficult. You know, people always go out and tell the priest when he does something wrong that they don't like. But how many of us say, thank you so much, Father, for preaching about the sanctity of human life. Thank you for telling us about our responsibility to defend the unborn.
Right.
Thank you. I have had very few opportunities to thank a priest for preaching on contraception, because I think I've heard maybe two or three homilies in my whole life on that issue. But I can tell you that if I hear one, and I did on the occasion that I can remember at my parish, I went up and said, oh, Father, thank you. I've been waiting for I don't know how many years to hear a priest preach the truth about that.
Wonderful. Great false.
Yeah.
Terry's
well, someone parish. Might accuse you of being a bunch of radical women running around trying to, you know, to provoke trouble. Mm-hmm. How would you face that issue?
We won't be contained by being labeled.
You wouldn't go.
If Jesus was radical. We love our faith. We have the truth. The priest shouldn't be afraid to give the people the truth. That's what they hunger for. The Orthodox parishes are the ones that are filled to the brim. People are just hungry now. Even the youth are coming back. At the March for Life, so much of the group was young people. It was beautiful, as opposed to even 10 years ago. There were much more.
And we're called to be a side of contradiction. And so if people look at us and say, these women are really, I mean, this is really strange, then we must be doing the right thing, because we're supposed to be counterculture. We're supposed to be a sign of contradiction to the world. And that's what we want to be. And we also want to send a message that, you know, women can be strong. Women can be articulate. And they can also be filled with faith. It isn't the National Organization for Women and groups like that who are talking about, you know, making career opportunities for women. You know, it's like all those women who stay home are stupid and dumb and have nothing to say. Well, we're well educated, and we love the faith, and we love our families. But I worked for the government, and I was on the fast track. I probably would have been up in the upper echelons of the federal government at this point had I stayed on my job. But I could be replaced in 5 minutes at that job. No one can replace me at home. I have a cosmic influence on my children, mm-hmm. that affects not only them, but every single person they ever touch in their whole life. And I'm happy to be home, and I'm happy to have chosen homeschooling for my younger children and to still be homeschooling my 12-year-old, because I'm going to have an influence on her for the rest of her life, and I'm going to have an influence on her family and on my grandchildren that she has. And so we want to say to women, be proud of being mothers. Be proud of being home.
What would you want all the ladies who are listening to you or who will listen to you in the later broadcasts, what do you want them to do with your organization? Are you calling upon everybody to come and join you? Are you reaching out to them? Are you spreading out beyond Arlington Diocese? What is your agenda?
We're waiting to see what the Blessed Mother tells us to do. But right now, yes, we would like people to subscribe to our newsletter, and I hope that the address is going to appear up on the screen.
Yeah, we're going to put it on the screen.
It's P.O. Box
1211, Vienna, Virginia, 22183-1211.
And we're going to begin trying to educate through our newsletter and wait and see what the Lord does with our group. It could be that at some point we begin to offer conferences where we can actually bring people together and have speakers and try to educate in that kind of a milieu. We actually are going to be having a table at the Council for Catholic Women meeting in March at St. Michael's in Arlington, Virginia. I believe it's Saturday, March
mm-hmm.
the 9th.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're just going to wait and see what the Lord does with us. You know, sometimes you just take one step at a time, and
exactly.
He lights the lamp and He shows you that much. The Blessed Mother and Jesus have brought us to the point of publishing our newsletter, and we'll see what happens from there.
Well, you have committed yourself to the life and objectives of Saint Joan of Arc.
Saint Joan of Arc.
Saint Joan of Arc, and you have also mentioned the Blessed Virgin Mary's message of Fatima, which, if I remember, it was a call for all Christians to come back to prayer, mm-hmm. to say the rosary. How do you address yourself to that message?
We encourage people to become actively involved in the sacramental life. We would like to see an increase in devotion particularly to the Eucharist, to frequent the reception of the sacrament of penance,
mm-hmm.
to
that's very important, especially this is time of Lent.
Absolutely. And to Eucharistic adoration. Mm-hmm. We would like to see people commit to the daily recitation of the rosary. And we love the messages of Sister Faustina. This is a time that needs great mercy from God. This is has been a very bloody century. And so we hope people will adopt that devotion to the Divine Mercy.
What message would you want to give the present church leaders, the clergy, the bishops?
I'd like to see them teach the fullness of the faith. Don't be afraid, particularly don't be afraid to teach the truth about the beauty of the church's teaching on the sacredness of human sexuality. Preach the good news that about why contraception is wrong and the devastation that it's caused, and encourage people to come back to accepting that
yes.
message and promoting natural family planning.
Thank you very much. That has been very, very warming, and I'm sure a lot of our people are going to take a good look at your organization and try to follow what you are standing for. I think it is time for everybody who has been baptized to rededicate himself and herself to those commitments we made in baptism and the receiving of the Holy Ghost. I think what has caused a lot of problems in this world is that the good people have done nothing when the evil is prevailing. That has to stop. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
We hope you succeed in your work.
Thank you very much.
Da vi conti